At Datadog, we're dedicated to building products that deliver value to our users. Today, I am joining this month in Datadog to discuss our approach to product development. Let's get started.
Hello, and welcome to This Month in Datadog, where we'll update you on our latest features, product announcements, events, and more. This month, we're switching up our usual coverage to bring you an in-depth conversation with two of Datadog's leaders. I'm excited to sit down with both Senior Vice President of Engineering, David Mitchell, and our Chief Product Officer, Yanbing Li. But before we get to those, we want to let you know about a recent change to the Datadog Certification Program. Now, you can sign up for a certification exam on our new and improved platform, where you can take the exam virtually or at one of over 1,000 test centers around the world. Whether you're working on a certification in Datadog Log Management, APM, or the platform's fundamentals, you now have greater access to a test setting that's right for you. You can learn more by checking out our blog post, which we'll link to in the video's description, or head over to the website to start the certification process. And now, let's go to my conversation with Yanbing. Yanbing, thanks for joining us today.
Good to be here.
So you've been here about 6 months now. What's been the most surprising thing about Datadog for you?
Jeremy, maybe I'll start with what's not surprising. I was attracted to Datadog by the strong reputations of how great the products are. And what's definitely not surprising is customers truly love our product. And it's really refreshing to see how enterprise customers can love their product, because that's not common. I feel the entire organization, you know, from all the way to our founders, senior leaders, to our product managers and engineers, really obsess over all the details we have related to product development. And for me, what's surprising is the company truly take product to heart and how we, the levels of attention that we put into developing great products that our customers love.
Yeah, that's a great point. One thing that surprised me when I came here is every company will say, we're super customer focused. But Here, it's almost an obsession to your point. How do you think we continue to build what customers actually need?
As I think about how we develop products, you know, being customer centric, we try not to pretend that we know better than our customers. And so this is why we really listen to what our customers are looking for, what the problems they have, what feedback they have. We focus on iteration, not perfection, so that we get something quickly into our customers' hands and we get real concrete feedback. And another thing I also find refreshing is, you know, for our product managers, you know, they're not only driving product development, they're often expected to sell to the first 10, 50 customers. So they really understand what it takes for customers to find value in our products, for them to adopt it, for them to be willing to pay, so that we know this is something that's truly solving a problem for them.
So speaking of solving problems, that doesn't just apply, in my opinion, to the products we build ourselves. Can you tell me how we apply that to acquisitions as well?
Yeah, Datadog is fundamentally a platform, and we take this approach even for the product that we acquire. You know, rather than chasing near-term revenue, we often spend months in integrating the acquired technology into our platform. So when customers get this product, they get that native unified Datadog platform experience. And I have to say, all the attention that we put in building a robust platform not only allow customers to have that integrated experience, but also allow our engineering team to iterate really fast in driving high feature velocity on top of that robust platform.
So the Datadog platform, which is a very unified platform, but it covers quite a bit from infrastructure to security to now product analytics. Is there one or two use cases that you're particularly excited about for 2025?
Yeah, as I learn more about Datadog, clearly, you know, we are not only a leader in observability, but we are really getting to many adjacent areas, as you mentioned. I think the use case I'm truly excited about, one of them, is providing end-to-end observability to our customers. Because customers come to Datadog, they don't want to just for us to monitor and provide insight into one part of what they do, but for the ability to understand deeply their infrastructure, their application, their real user experience, the analytics on top of their product, the security posture of their their applications and their infrastructure. So I'm excited about, you know, us truly providing that end-to-end observability to our customers. And this is one of the motivation for us to truly get into these different adjacency. Besides the end-to-end observability, I'm also excited how we take observability into action. You know, I've spoken to lots of the customers. They tell me, you know, you have all the data, you have all the insight, you have all the context. Why can't you provide much more meaningful recommendation or even take action? I think this is an area of focus for us, you know, taking that rich observability insight and not just turning into alerts, but really meaningful recommendations and remediations. And when customers get confidence in our recommendations, we can even take action on their behalf. And especially with the emergence of AI, as we apply AI across our platform, our ability to take action and close the loop is really becoming much, much more capable, and our customers really want it.
Yeah, that journey from benevolent observer to mm-hmm. willingness to take action in customer environments really was a step change for us, and it unlocks a lot of potential for what we can do.
Absolutely.
You mentioned AI. AI, LLMs, super top of mind for a lot of people. What do you think we're going to do from an AI LLM perspective in the product that customers will be genuinely impactful for customers?
Yeah, I think, you know, it seems like nowadays we can't have any technical conversation without talking about AI. I think at Datadog, we are not getting into AI for the hype of AI, but really trying to make AI useful. And we take a two-pronged approach. One is we apply AI to everywhere inside the Datadog product so that Datadog can be more intelligent, more automated, and more action-oriented. You know, coming back to this taking action, going from alerting to quality recommendations and action, and applying AI across all the different aspects of our product. This is what we call the applied AI. The other aspect is, you know, Datadog is a leader in observability, and we want to be the leader in observability in the era of AI. You know, our customers are building AI applications at, you know, really high pace, and they're bringing these applications into production. So how do we provide native observability into LLM powered applications? You know, our customers are developing AI models, whether they are, you know, training their own, or they're augmenting something, or they're taking a commercial model, you know, how we help them evaluate their model development. That's another aspect. Last but not least, I know all of them are spending arm and leg on GPUs. And we also offer, you know, GPU level monitoring so that they get the best utilization and the best investment out of their GPU. So again, a full stack approach toward AI observability. That's the second effort we have around AI.
Excellent. Really appreciate you joining us today. And thanks again.
Thank you, Jeremy. Yeah, my pleasure.
Here's a quick roundup of the new features that Datadog recently announced. David, thanks for joining.
Yeah, excited to be here.
So you've been at Datadog about 5 years. Can you tell us a little bit about your journey here?
Yeah, when I started, we were about 1/5 the size we are today. I started looking after our integrations group and our infrastructure monitoring team. And that grew over time to looking after logs and some other groups within Datadog. And I think the thing I've always been impressed with is just how pragmatic and practical we've grown, being able to iterate like our processes and our org structure over time so that we could actually meet the scale and make sure we're focusing on the right things, make sure we're focusing on what we're building for our customers. So,
one thing that's impressed me, aside from that focus with the engineering org here at Datadog, is the velocity is just, I've never seen anything like it. Can you tell us a little bit about our culture here and how it enables that velocity?
I think one of the things is, you know, that customer focus definitely helps, like, you know, constrain us as far as like how we're thinking about what our focuses are and our priorities are. In addition, we're very bottoms up. So, you know, we make sure that teams feel like they own their product, they own that product direction. They're closest to the technology, they're closest to the customers, so they can make the right decisions. And I think that allows them to move really quickly, right? To be able to iterate, to be able to learn, and then try again.
Speaking of culture, at Dash last year, you gave a talk that really, we were thoughtful about rethinking what we thought of observability, but also as our journey from benevolent observer, which is what we were for most of the organization's lifetime, to being able to, and willing and able to go into a customer's environment and make changes, really is a step change for us. For those that weren't able to see that talk, can you give us some of the lessons learned and just a really quick overview of that?
Yeah. I think, you know, what guided me to do that talk actually was just realizing how much culture played into what we were building. To your point, like, we'd viewed ourselves as the benevolent observer, like we never wanted to change a customer's environment or interact with the way they did operations. And so thinking about, like, okay, now with security, we recognize that in order for us to build a great security product, we're gonna have to change that. We're gonna have to be able to influence a customer's environment more, make changes to their environment. What we realized in the process of developing that and getting people to start thinking about that differently is just how much our culture dictated, like, how we built things and the types of risk we were willing to take. So we took this very iterative approach to it, you know, building one specific thing, working with a smaller team, understanding, like, how to change their mindset, but also figuring out what those boundaries were. Like, how did we want to think about building that product as well as enter, you know, into this new world of being able to configure a customer's environment. The outcome of that was that we communicated a whole lot. We had to, like, make sure we brought other people along that same journey. So actually had to build frameworks to, like, hey, how do we introduce this to new teams? How do we make sure they understand and they take the same lessons we learned? And then I think the other thing that was surprising for me, at least, was we recognized that we had to continue to iterate even afterwards, because we'd be approached with new problems or new approaches that teams wanted to make in order to use that capability. And we had to think, okay, is this in line with what we want to do? Is this how we want to actually manage and use customers' environments and make sure they're aware and they're comfortable with it too, and continue to refine that process and then recommunicate and do it all again, right?
It was really interesting to see that journey from my vantage point. It's the people problems are the difficult problems to solve. And to your point, that iteration is something that I really appreciate here. You know, Alexei's off, our CTO, has often said, we don't always get it right to start, but we often get it right in the end, and iteration is a huge part of that.
Yeah, and I think that's a core part of Datadog, is like we are definitely very humble in terms of, like, you know, how we approach a problem. We don't think we come with all the answers. It's more we're here to learn and make sure we're building the right thing for our customers, to listen to our customers, but also see what's actually possible in the domain of our expertise overall, right?
So you and I talk about technology a lot. We genuinely love this stuff, right? What technologies do you think are really the engineers at Datadog excited about right now?
I think that any technology that's fast and safe gets our engineers pretty excited. I can't say there's, like, one particular one. I think the one that we've definitely invested in, like, time and time again, and we've been experimenting more with is the Rust language. So if you look at our acquisitions about 4 years ago, we acquired Vector, and then later, just recently, we acquired QuickWit. Both of those are based in Rust. And I think what we've realized, like, a combination of, like, the safety in terms of being type safe and memory safe, just like the speed that it actually gives us and being able to determine where's the right place to insert that and to actually build around that. So most recently we launched a brand new Lambda layer that's all Rust based that, like, definitely knocked our socks off in terms of performance. We're starting to do that same thing within the agent, like looking at parts of that, like, makes sense for us to introduce Rust. And we're seeing some of that, like, in our backend systems too, you know, where we, like, have high demands for security and safety as well as performance, and it ends up being pretty powerful.
It fits in very well with what we do as an organization. I noticed you didn't say AI once in that entire time. Obviously, AI and LLMs are super top of mind for engineers everywhere. What are your thoughts on how we're using AI to build or what we're using it internally, but also on the product side, how are we thinking about AI and LLM?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of unknown territory right now. I think one interesting, like, knock-on effect, which is maybe not exactly where you're going, is, you know, we have a lot of GPU capacity now that are older GPUs, right? Because as these big companies are training these models, they're always having to use the fastest and newest. And I think we're seeing some companies, including ourselves, that are realizing there's other types of jobs that actually benefit from this parallel processing that GPUs give us. So we've been thinking a lot just from a product standpoint of, like, how do we make sure we monitor those well, that we give like good insights to our customers? So whether they're building an LLM or whether they're experimenting with just parallel processing generally, they get the most out of it. Like longer term, as far as Datadog and things that we keep experimenting with is, you know, we just released a new model and we're still looking at, you know, what are ways that we can use AI. AI is very good at predicting things. That means a lot in our industry or our particular domain. Because customers want to know, like, what is the forecast? Where is, you know, how is my system going to perform, like, under certain load conditions, et cetera? So I think there's a lot of things that we're experimenting with there. And I think that hope is, or someday maybe we have that concept of a digital twin, which, you know, it's been described to me as being able to mimic the human body and see how drugs react. Maybe we can do that same thing in the context of complex systems that we run, right? Be able to model those in a way, and customers be able to say, "Hey, I'm expecting this load or this workload. How's my system going to perform? How much is it going to cost me, et cetera?"
So. Exciting times. Really looking forward to what's next.
Yeah, same.
Awesome. Well, thanks again for joining. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Special thanks to David and Yanbing for joining us today. Before we go, we've got a sneak peek of Dash 2025 just for you. This year, Dash is returning to North Javits in New York City for what's gearing up to be our biggest event ever. The agenda is so packed, we've already added a pre-conference day filled with exclusive workshops and partner events. That means more sessions, more customer stories, more hands-on training, more networking, more Datadog. You're not going to want to miss this year's Dash. Check out the link in our video description to register today and take advantage of early bird pricing. And that wraps up today's episode. If you have a question, comment, or suggestion for a future episode, comment below or email us. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel for future episodes of This Month in Datadog. See you next month.